Ονομάζομαι Κατερίνα Ρουμπή. Είμαι μία από τους γεωπόνους του Allegra Grow Shop και του Cannabis Project. Το Allegra Grow Shop έχει 19 χρόνια εμπειρία στην καλλιέργεια φαρμακευτικής κάναβης, γιατί πιστεύουμε ότι είναι ένα φυτό το οποίο είναι πρωτοπόρο και μοναδικό από μόνο του και έχει πάρα πολλά να μας προσφέρει. Χάρη σε αυτή την εμπειρία που έχουμε των 19 χρόνων και στο δίκτυο των 9 καταστημάτων στην Ελλάδα και στις αποθήκες μας Ελλάδα, Βουλγαρία και Ισπανία, έχουμε καταφέρει να δημιουργήσουμε κάποιες συνεργασίες μακροχρόνιες με εταιρείες ηγέτες του κλάδου, όπως επίσης και με πανεπιστήμια. Χάρη σε αυτό, μπορούμε και προσφέρουμε στους πελάτες μας όχι μόνο ποιοτικά προϊόντα, αλλά και υποστήριξη μετά τις αγορές. Επίσης, αυτές οι εταιρείες και οι φορείς, όπως και εμείς, έχουμε τη διάθεση να μοιραστούμε τη γνώση και την εμπειρία, με στόχο τη δημιουργία προϊόντων κάναβης ανταγωνιστικών, με όσο το δυνατόν πιο εύκολο και οικονομικό τρόπο. Έτσι, σήμερα διοργανώνεται αυτή η μερίδα με αυτό το στόχο, σε συνδιοργάνωση με τη ΔΕΘ, όπως είπαμε, την οποία ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ για την τιμή που μας κάνει. Η μερίδα είναι εφόλης της ύλης όσον αφορά την κάναβη καλλιεργητικά και μετασυλλεκτικά και στο θέμα της αποθήκευσης. Επομένως, θα ξεκινήσουμε με την Advanced Nutrients, που είναι μια εταιρεία με 24 χρόνια εμπειρίας. Από το 1999 ασχολείται με λιπάσματα εξειδικευμένα για την καλλιέργεια της κάναβης και πρόσφατα βραβεύτηκε ως η καλύτερη εταιρεία για αυτά τα λιπάσματα. Θα δώσω το λόγο στους κυρίους Νίκολα Σιλβέστρη, Φρανσέσκο Καντζιούλη και Χωσέ Μάνουελ Λόπες.
Thank you very much for being here. Thank you very much to Allegra and Cannabis Project to involve in this experience. Thank you to Agrotica to give a space to the cannabis companies to speak and diffuse this topic that needs to be on the top of all topics in agriculture, in my opinion. So just a quick presentation. I am Nicola Silvestri. I am the area manager of Advanced Nutrients in the Southern Europe. I'm here today with Jose, that is the LP manager of Advanced Nutrients Europe, and Francesco, that is our sales rep and cultivation responsible in Italy. So I'm going to make a short presentation about the company. For the one who already knows Advanced Nutrients, I will give some more information, some news. For the one who doesn't know Advanced Nutrients, I will tell who we are. So essentially, we are an international marketer and manufacturer of agricultural home and garden fertilizers and plant nutrients. It's 23 years that we are producing specific fertilizer cannabis. We are the number one producer of pharmaceutical grade cannabis nutrients, as I said, since 1999, more than 23 years. The company is a worldwide company. We sell our products in more than 100 countries across the world. The company was born in the other side of the ocean, Canada, and then moved from to United States. Our branch is in Barcelona. From Barcelona, we serve all this side of the world. There in Barcelona, we have our factory, production plant offices, plus we have a team across Europe of sales and tech. Okay, here just a couple of pictures. The factory was inaugurated in November last year. We have a mixing facility, processing facility, and three bottling lines from the small bottle to the 20 liters bottle. We can produce containers up to 1,000 liters, 200 liters. So our capacity is it's very high. The production plant is brand new, high technology in it. And we are around 40 employees working in the production and warehouse. Now, I will give just some key facts about Advanced Nutrients and some news of last year. Okay, as I said, just a few facts from 2022. I mentioned that we are selling our products all across the world, more than 100 countries, from Turkey to South America, from Finland to South Africa, essentially all across the globe. Our innovation influenced the market in the last 20 years. We have this list of what we call the 50 first, so 50 innovation we implemented in the cannabis market for the first time. I will mention just a couple of that, then if you want you can reach us, I can pass all the information. But we were more than 15 years ago, 16 years ago to be precise, the first company to be granted the license to grow cannabis for research purpose. This was in our laboratories in United States. We were the first company producing a complete hydroponic fertilizing system for cannabis, and so on. The first three-component fertilizer in the cannabis industry, and many innovation like that change the cannabis market and the way to feed the cannabis plant. In 2022, I want to mention these two things. We are quite proud. We are proud of that. In 2022, we were named the best cannabis nutrient brand at Spannabis. Spannabis is the most important expo in the cannabis industry here in Europe. It's held in Barcelona in March. So last March, we were named, awarded the best cannabis nutrients. That was a great result. The Big Bud, it's our flowering booster, was named best product in the market. And on top of that, always in 2022, we were named best brand on Grow Diaries, that is an online resource for growers all across the world that share their experience and their knowledge. So this was just to mention a couple of things. Again, we are going to be at the expo until Sunday with Allegre Cannabis Project. You can reach us. We can provide more information, or you can find anything online. So in 2022, we launched globally a new line of products. This line of products is aimed at commercial growth. The market is changing. Of course, in United States and Canada, it's changing faster because they have a regulation there. They moved from small underground growers to bigger and commercial growers. So in this shift, we created this new line of fertilizer. Francesco and Jose will speak deeply about the products later on. I will just mention that we have a powder base, that is the Sensi Professional Series, two flowering boosters in powder, Big Bud and Mud Blood, and a root enhancer, that are bacterias and mycorrhizae, in tablets. Okay, this is essentially the new dry line of fertilizer we launched this year, aimed at commercial growth. We are already using that with different clients across Europe, in Portugal, Italy, and Macedonia, and other countries. So this is just a quick outlook at our portfolio. As you can see, we have a lot of different products for each need of different growers on different cultivation projects. We will not talk deeply about all the products because we don't have time, but Francesco will give a quick outlook on the categories of product we have and give some information, relevant information about some of the products in our line. So, for me it's over. I pass the word to Francesco. Again, thank you very much for being here and to keep attention to what we are saying.
Hi, good morning, καλημέρα. I'm gonna speak slow just to give her the opportunity to translate, and I would like to tell you that we are not going so deep, but I will give to each one of you my business card. If you want to speak better by email or WhatsApp, it will be possible to go deeper for each question that you will have now or in the future. So, I am Francesco, the sales rep and cultivation manager in Italy, and I'm in love with this plant since a long time. I grew my first plants more than 20 years ago, and I'm still learning. In the last year, I've been in many shops and farms all around Italy and some many countries, just to give a recommendation, just to explain how they can reach better results with advanced nutrients. And my job is just to give this information and then make the follow-up, just follow what happens after my visit. As Nicola was saying, we have a huge quantity of different products because we would like to give you the opportunity to make perfect your own choice for each setup. We have a lot of different products also because today we reached our 8th generation of specific cannabis fertilizers. So in 23 years of experience, we find a lot of different solutions and different point of view, we can say. And so we give all this kind of answer to build up your own line. We decide to separate also in the imagine our products from categories just to be easier to take a look and also to give you an explanation. Now I'm gonna be more specific on these categories. Starting from the base nutrient category, we can speak about the different ways of give the base nutrients. We have a full mineral line that is called Jungle Juice and is a total mineral, old style base nutrient, and is the cheaper that we have. Then we have organic mineral concept, and in this kind of base we have the Grow, Bloom and Micro. It's a three component base nutrient. Then we have the Sensi Grow and Bloom B component base nutrients, and also the Connoisseur Grow A and B, and Bloom A and B, also a B-component based nutrient. These organic mineral bases have inside the three types all what we call the five benefits in one. The five benefits that we put in the bottle, as well with macro and secondary nutrients, are the humic acids, fulvic acids, a non-ionic surfactant, a complex of amino acids, and the pH-perfect technology, we can say. Those are the five benefits that you will find just only using the base nutrient of the organo-mineral solution. Then, for the organic growers, the full organic growers, we have the Iguana Grow and Bloom base nutrients. They are triple filtered, blend of kelp, fish extract, and yeast extracts, and a proper blend of plants extracts. So it's a really, really good organic line because it's really clean in the irrigation system, for example, but is really also technical. It's really modern as a concept. It's really clean and is going to give heavy results. Then, the last thing about bases is that Sensi Grow and Bloom and Connoisseurs Grow and Bloom are also available with a cocoa-specific formulation, because if your substrate, your cultivation media will be 100% cocoa, you will need some specific nutrients. Then we go to the next category, is the bigger buds. We call it the bigger buds tribe. The Bigger Buds tribe is composed by three of the most famous of our products, because we use them in the flowering time, but also about the effect. They are really special and particular. We start speaking with the Bud Igniter, this one. The bud igniter is for the early stage of the blooming phase and is formulated to give an insight input to the plant to start blooming. With this product, your plants will show the flower also 7 days earlier, and that increases the flower productive spots also. You have to use bud igniter only the first 2 weeks of blooming phase, and that's it. Then, big bud, the central one, is the most famous stimulator in all the cannabis world. It's the product that Nicola was saying also win the award this year as the best cannabis fertilizer in the Spannabis Expo. So we are really proud to have it because maybe it's also the most iconic product in this business compartment. It's the central blooming phase booster that will increase the dimension of your buds. And the rare fact, the special fact of this product is that it's a bloom booster that contain low quantities of PK, phosphorus and potassium. A lot of different, the most diffuse fertilization programs gives a lot of phosphorus and potassium during the fruit and flowers production. We decide to have a different approach, giving directly to the plant more than 20 amino acids that the plant will use as building blocks instead of making herself all the hard job. This is the specialty of this product. Use this product, Big Bud, from the week 2 up to the week 5 of the blooming phase. Then we have the Overdrive, this one. And Overdrive is the product that you will give to reach the most compact and heavy crop. It's a product that gives 1 week more to the plant to produce flower mass and contains the proper quantities of micro and secondary elements to make your flower really dense. This is the part, the characteristic. Overdrive is what will change really the weight of the harvest and the aesthetic of the flower. So if you are a commercial, also medical grower, you will need this kind of product to reach the best and give a sense to your grow. And you have to use Overdrive in the week 6 and 7 of the blooming phase. Moving to the next category, we are gonna speak about this product that are bud potency and stalk straightener. And I will tell you just little things about this kind of product, but this category of is composed by product that will give to your plant some more tools to reach the true genetic potential. There is the rhino skin that will provide to your plants stronger cells, for example. Then we have the B52 that will give a complex of B vitamins that will show you healthier plants, for example. Then there is the Nirvana, that is a blend of more than 80 organic extracts. And then we have the Bud Factor X, that is our unicorn, we can say. It's a product that is really loved from the medical growers, because it will determine, it could determine a dramatic increase of resins production, so you will have more essential oil, more terpenoids, more cannabinoids. So for what is the concentration, the molecules, what we are trying to reach out from the plant in the medical compartment will be really helped by the Bud Factor X product. Then we go to the next category, and we have three different products as root mass expanders, and they are called Voodoo Juice, Piranha, and Tarantula. And our root expanders are all bacteria and fungus. We decide to put them in three different containers just to ensure the final user that different species doesn't will fight to dominate in high concentration. Our scientist team selected that specific bacteria that have benefic relationship with the plant and determine a root mass expansion to colonize better your substrate. This is the fact. At the same time, this special team, we can say, these bacteria and fungus, will help you to be sure that the root zone won't take bad fungus and bacteria, because if you colonize it with good ones, you will be sure also that the bad one will not come. And this is another amazing effect that we have. An important thing when you're using bacteria and fungus is always to remember, give them some food. So some sugars, we offer the Bud Candy product and also another one. But it's really important, because if you want that the colonies will develop in your substrate, you need to give some sugar and just to feed them. Then we move to the next category. As Nicola was saying, from the 2022, we start proposing also the dry fertilization. And this line was really thought about the needs, the exigencies of large-scale producers, recreational or medical. But you will see that the formats, for example, and also the mindset that is behind this line is completely different, because we need to move with a different approach to bigger clients. This is really the first powder product really developed for cannabis plants, and you see it because it's separated the vegetative stage to the bloom phase, and you will see the specific macro and secondary nutrients in that ratio that it's really, really specific for cannabis. It's not the same with other plants. We have a lot of difference. For example, a cannabis plant is not one that eats more nitrogen in veg than in bloom, so it's really counterintuitive in this case. We made our studies, and then from the studies we reach the product. It's not that we made some product and with the product we made some study. This is the point. So we developed these powders to be easy to dissolve, for example. It's a really important thing for us. Then we have, for example, the Voodoo Juice Plus tablets, this product here. These tablets will contain the bacteria and fungus that used to be in the three bottles that we speak about earlier. And one tablet will be 1 gram, and 1 gram tablet, it's suitable for 100 gallons of water, more or less 350 liters, just to give you an example of what we mean with large-scale production. Then we have the Big Bud powder that maintain all the good qualities of the liquid product, but is more comfortable to stock and mix in big quantities. And then the Bud Blood, that is a product that you only will use in the first week of blooming phase, just to ignite, to give this input that will start all the blooming process in the plant. And the last thing about the Sensi powders, the basis that I would like to share with you, is that it contains different forms of nitrogen, for example, nitric and ureic nitrogen, and three different forms of chelate of iron, just to give you the best uptake possible in many different conditions. This is really developed for give you an easy life quite in each condition. Then, the last thing that I will say is that we are following a lot of different realities with this setup of product. They are really happy, so this is a full line. You will not need too much more of this. But if you want, because maybe you come from the liquid world, you just know some product of our line and you appreciate it, it's also possible to use some of our liquid additives to integrate the line. So, thank you for your time. I'm going to give the word to Jose. And he will give you a good look about some case study.
Ευχαριστώ. Thank you. Okay. Ο Χωσέ θα μας μιλήσει για ορισμένες μελέτες, case studies, δηλαδή μελέτες συγκεκριμένων περιπτώσεων.
Okay. Hi all. I'm José Manuel López, and I have been providing commercial and technical support to cannabis growers for more than 10 years. I'm working with cannabis the last 23 years. And well, in Advanced Nutrients, we have been working for 2 years directly with medical cannabis license in Europe, giving a fertilization solution and also to CBD and industrial hemp companies. In addition to the experience we collect during these 2 years in the use of our nutrients with LPs, we also have the experience and satisfaction of thousands of growers all over the world, mainly on a big scale. Mainly on a big scale in Canada and in the USA. Like my teammate said, we have the factory in Barcelona. Also, we have a big warehouse. So this is one of the most important points in Advanced Nutrients in Europe to the long producers, because we are prepared to serve the product in the same moment and the plants needed. Well, to start the summary about big projects in Europe, in Italy, I would like to talk to you about industrial hemp cultivation. We are currently developing a new product for this market, something more specific for countries where fertilization is not applied to these crops because to the climatic and environmental conditions, and also for industrial hemp cultivation, depending on the purpose for which the plant is to be used, the application of irrigation gives a decrease in productivity per hectare, for example, if we are talking about fibers for construction. Hemp cultivation also can be made for a multitude of purposes, like, for example, for seed production, where the application of irrigation greatly increases the productivity per hectare. Currently, we have in our portfolio 2 options, both of them, water soluble powder and jungle juice, are very versatile and which can be adapted to both of these cultivars, cannabis and industrial hemp crops, simply changing the dosage of each of the parts, depending the product the farmer is looking for. The dosification will be different if you are looking for seeds or looking for fibers, and soil characteristics aren't the same also, so we will give you the support to give the success, no? Okay, here you have some examples, cultivation for seeds and textile production. They are in Spain. Both of them only have tree irrigation in vegetative and first and last week of flowering, and with a background amendment in the middle of Spain, they are. Okay, this is for seeds and textile, and here you have another example with flowers, outdoor, also in the south of Spain. And well, in Spain we have to, the maximum is 0.2 of THC, so we have to adapt the fertilization to don't increase these levels. Okay, here we have another example, but in indoor. It's a big facility with 8 rooms like that, and well, the same problem. We have to give the fertilization to get the maximum production, but don't increase the 0.2 of THC. On the other hand, our companies were famous for specific cultivation products with high THC levels and a great terpene profile, cannabis in this case. Now, because the boom of creation of medical cannabis license in Europe and even recreational in some countries, this market is growing very fast. And this is one example in Portugal. Okay. I will differentiate our portfolio and client typology in 3 different cases depending the nutrient. The first one is the organic. Here you have one example of the one organic system irrigation and also the barrels of 200 liters. Okay, organic is used because it's a requirement from the final buyer for a purely organic certified product. At the moment, this type of customer is minimal, but my point of view is that when recreational cultivation is working, this type of fertilization will grow also, mainly from 2030 onwards. Okay, I will show you 2 examples of organic crops, outdoor and greenhouse. This is the outdoor in Portugal the last year, 4 hectares. And this is the development of the flowers in the finish of the bloom stage. And this is a greenhouse, the same, no? They need an organic nutrient, and this is the results of use our nutrients. Okay. Usually it's more expensive, around 30-40% the use of organic nutrients, but at the end it's a demand of the final buyer, so they need use these products. Okay. The next one, the water soluble powder that Francesco was talking about. We have bought of two-part base fertilizer and APK with a very, very competitive price. Is the option for those who want to minimize price and to improve logistics and storage to have a better operability. We have customers where the price per crop is 1 euro per gram, and they must have the absence of heavy metals, a clean product for operability that doesn't obstruct the drippers, and well, Sensi Professional Line is their option, being a specific product for cannabis that helps the organoleptic qualities and THC levels to be maximum. It's very common to see customers with low production, low terpene levels, hermaphroditins problems, and often the reason of the problem is the fertilizer. Usually they are using agricultural products that they are in, specific for cannabis, and they have this problem because of that. Fertilization is not the main key factor on the success of cannabis cultivation, and I sell nutrients. Genetic is the more important, for example, in my point of view, but the nutrition is a key aspect that helps to exploit the genetic we are working with, like the environmental conditions, for example, and it's very important give to cannabis plants the extra ratios that they need without heavy metals to get a top quality product. Okay, we have here one example with water soluble powder, Portugal also, this amount of plants every 2 months. Here we have a video, but we have a problem with the exportation, and like I show you, it's a video where we mix the product and you can see the 100% solubility with the water, but it's not possible to show. And well, finally, we have the organo-mineral option in liquid fertilizer. We have multitude of additives, like Francesco showed you, depending the requirement of the plant in very different situations and stages. Some customers who have been growing with Advanced Nutrients for 20 years continue to use this line because they know the results it offers and they trust in these products. The cost per plant is bigger, around 25% bigger than with the 100% mineral or powder option, but the yield and the results are worth the investment, as long as the price per gram must be more than 2 or 3 euros per gram to invest in this kind of fertilizer of nutrients. My suggestion initially is always use water soluble powder and some additives, depending the strain or the final product is looking for. Trying don't increase the final cost by plant too much. So initially I don't recommend this line because I prefer look for the best price for the farmer. No? But in any way, the results are very good, and if the cost of the final product is higher, they can do the nutrition with this product because we'll have a return in money. No? I show you another example. It's a customer that use one agricultural product like Bas Nutrients, and he used the additives from Advanced Nutrients to increase the production, increase the THC levels, like Bas Factor S, for example. Okay, and me and our technicians will evaluate the characteristics of the crop and provide all the necessary support to get the best final product. In all the cases, we analyze what the producer needs, depending the facility, the environmental conditions, DLI, BPD, humidity, CO2, irrigation system they have, the final product he's looking for, the estimated cost by plant, very important point, and we will look for the best solution, not only with nutrients. Our bigger satisfaction, my bigger satisfaction, is that until this moment, all customers in Europe that start working with us continue working with us because all of them had the results they were looking for with yield, quality, and support. And this is our big goal, and we are very proud of this. Many thanks for your attention. It's all from my side. Thank you. And here you have our contacts. If you have any question, you are welcome.
He wants to ask for the organic line that you have, okay. Iguana juice. Where is the what is the origin of
the raw materials
of the nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. That
okay, I can send you if you want, or give after the meeting all the information about the organic. I can say that all the products from the organic line are made in USA, in California, and the standards of the organic line are very strict there. We have a certification in California, and they are very strict. For example, we have to demonstrate all the seaweed we have in our products are sustainable with the nature, you know. So all the our organic line have all the certification you can need, no? Think probably we have 200 raw materials in all the organic line, so it's very extensive. Give sadly what components we have in all the line, but if you want, I can show you all the products and see one by one what raw materials we have, no?
Ναι, θα τον ρωτήσω απλώς, just a moment, θα τον ρωτήσω αυτό που μου είπατε. Απλώς οι συγκεκριμένες ποικιλίες που καλλιεργούνται για αυτό το στόχο της βιομηχανικής κάναβης είναι ποικιλίες που έχει επιτρέψει και εγκρίνει η Ευρωπαϊκή Ένωση για το σκοπό αυτής της καλλιέργειας της βιομηχανικής και το γενετικό του υλικό είναι τέτοιο που παράγουν ούτως ή άλλως μικρά ποσοστά της τετραϊδροκαναβινόλης που είπαμε. Μικρά ποσοστά και μπορούν να φτάσουν το 0,2% και σίγουρα επηρεάζονται και από τους εξωτερικούς παράγοντες που ανέφερε. Αλλά είναι και θέμα της ποικιλίας αυτό. Θα σας απαντήσει και ο ίδιος. She asks how are affected the plants and their potency. From the nutrients, because you said for the 0.2, I answered that they are the specific varieties.
Okay, we are specialists in increase the THC levels, but for sure there are customers and growers that need don't increase this level, so we avoid use some products to don't increase these levels. No, we can get a bigger production, but don't increase with bad factor X, for example, Nirvana, these amounts of THC. Mm-hmm. But the most important point in this topic always is the genetic, in my point of view. The nutrients only help to increase the potential the strain has, you know? It's more important the genetic than the nutrient, but the nutrition at the end is a tool to get the maximum the are you looking for. And other products, Nirvana, Tarantula, for example, can increase this level, so I always recommend don't use these products if you can increase this level. In Spain, we have the problem the maximum is 0.2. In Italy, for example, is 0.5, no? 6 in Switzerland is 1.0, I think. So we have more margin to apply other products and increase the cannabinoids because we have margin with the THC also, increasing the cannabinoids. But at the end, depending on the country, we can use one product or not. I have the support from my teammate. No sé si quieres.
No, yes. Yes. The fact I was speaking also before with the TV people is that in Europe we have really, really different regulation in small territories. So, for example, Greece and Italy could be really similar as environmental and climatic things, but it will be really, really different the project that we will follow because the laws will be different. And this is also why we give all these kind of products because we don't know where and how what we are going to produce the next time. So we want to be near to each one of the different cannabis producers.
Okay. Ευχαριστούμε πολύ. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Τώρα πάμε στην επόμενη ομιλία. που είναι στο θέμα του τεχνητού φωτισμού. Απλώς θα γίνει διαδικτυακά, γιατί υπήρξε ένα πρόβλημα υγείας. Θα συνδεθούμε τώρα και θα συνεχίσουμε. Θα συνεχίσουμε την ημερίδα με την εταιρεία Lumotech Lighting. Είναι μια ευρωπαϊκή εταιρεία κορυφαία στον χώρο του τεχνητού φωτισμού, ο οποίος είναι και αυτός ένα από τα απαραίτητα στοιχεία για την καλλιέργεια της κάναβης, ιδίως σε εσωτερικούς χώρους. Είναι μια εταιρεία με μεγάλη πείρα στον κλάδο, η οποία εστιάζει στην έρευνα και την καινοτομία. Και τα προϊόντα της, ένα από τα πολύ θετικά που έχουν τα προϊόντα της για προϊόντα ηλεκτρολογικού εξοπλισμού γενικότερα, είναι ότι έχουν εγγύηση 5 χρόνων. Οπότε θα μας μιλήσει ο Μαρτίν Βιάννα, που είναι ο Chief Product και Brand Officer της εταιρείας, και ο κύριος Ρώμεου Σάντος, ο οποίος είναι στο τεχνικό κομμάτι. Hello, Martim and Romeo. Nice to see you. Θα κάνουμε την ομιλία αυτή διαδικτυακά, διότι έχει προκύψει ένα πρόβλημα υγείας. Λυπούνται και οι ίδιοι που δεν μπορούν να είναι εδώ, αλλά θα προσπαθήσουμε για το καλύτερο χάρη στην τεχνολογία. Και σύντομα θα υπάρχουν και τα βίντεο στο κανάλι μας και στην ιστοσελίδα μας σε σύντομο χρονικό διάστημα για να τα δείτε. Okay. Yes, just a moment. Για τη βιντεοσκόπηση. Are you taping this meeting, Martin?
Sorry?
Are you taping this? Are you recording?
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you, thank you. Thank you, okay. So we can start.
Okay.
So first of all,
as it was already presented by Katrina, I'm Martin, Chief of Product and Brand Officer
Yes.
So just a curiosity to light up the sensor. Sunlight is filtered by our atmosphere at sea level. The atmosphere absorbs a big part of the harmful radiation, which is an atmosphere that we observe. And at the sea level, around 45% of sunlight falls into the photosynthetic active radiation part. I will insist a lot on this term during the presentation because it's a very important question we're talking about light and plants together. So in this image here, it represents spectral energy distribution of solar radiation at the top of the atmosphere and at the sea level. So, and as I was saying, just a small part of the solar radiation, 45%, is used by plants. So, move forward. Ultraviolet or UV light is divided in, as you see from this table, in UVC. And UVC, for example, usually is used to produce artificial for disinfecting purposes. UVB, on our day-to-day as humans, it's actually the way responsible to cause skin burn, but obviously that we'll cover later on. UVB also has benefits for plants if used properly. UVA causes stem elongation, and then the classic, as we were mentioning, the 400% nanometers vision is the visible spectrum for plant photosynthesis. I'm sorry for this table. It says the UVC from 2020 to 2020. It's just a latitude. It's a big unit. So UVC is a mean unit. So photons. Photons basically are used to quantify light into a measurable object or particle in horticulture and other industries. These are affected by gravity, and the light wave frequency can determine the speed at which light passes through objects. Photons are critical to drive the plant's photosynthesis. To describe the role of light in the process of photosynthesis, it is best to think of light as a number of particles or a number of photons. On the left side image, it gives us an idea that as photons coming to a source won't follow a particular orientation. They actually travel randomly. And on the right side, photons have different color corresponding to different color of the spectrum. That means that photons with different energy will also have different color.
Okay, so now we finished just a brief summary of light in general. So now we're going to move to the next chapter and the importance of light for plant growth. So plants use energy, as you can see in this scheme. Plants use the energy of photons, carbon dioxide, and water to generate sugars and oxygen. Without light, this chemical reaction won't work, simply. So basically, light triggers plants' photosynthesis by converting the carbon dioxide plus water into glucose and oxygen. So light is essential for seed germination or inhibited seed germination, depending on the species we are dealing with. Light influences plant format and affects flowering in photoperiodic crops. On the left side image, you can see short-day plants. That means that in order for plants to flower, the light duration should be decreased to the number of hours according to each plant species. For example, cannabis, we are talking about 12 hours of light to induce flowering. And on the right side, long-day plants, that in order to flower, the light duration should be increased. For example, lettuce, spinach, potatoes, etc. Oh, we move to the 9 cardinal parameters of plant growth. So basically, as we increase light intensity to push growth in plants, we can also expect that more water will be needed, more water and also nutrients, increase in photosynthesis, more gas exchanges, in this case carbon dioxide into oxygen, more transpiration. The amount of heating needed in your growth system will decrease, and the amount of cooling will increase. So in this picture here, it represents these 9 cardinal parameters for plant growth. And as you can see, as the light increases, we must make sure that also plants receive the ideal ratios of the rest of the parameters. So it's we should not increase just one, but pay attention to all these 9 cardinal parameters of plant growth. So light absorption, on average, 85 to 90% of PAR region reaching the leaves is absorbed. So the rest is transmitted or reflected. Plants absorb light in different stages. So we have stage 1 or level 1, where light is absorbed by the chlorophyll A, B, and carotenoids. Level 2, chloroplasts absorb spectrum and also releases oxygen regarding light color. And before going to the other two levels. You can see on the left side image shows us chlorophyll A and B absorbing light from different ranges of the spectrum. At the center, we have the carotenoid pigments that induces photosynthesis of plants, which is mainly blue light. And the last one on the right, different colors of the spectrum affects the gas exchanges. So blue and red light are the main light that increases oxygen release in this case. And now the other two levels, so level three, absorption by the leaves, where light radiation transmitted in the green area of the spectrum and consequently penetrates the leaf tissue, is both scattered and reflected. Plants also use the green light for photosynthesis. In level four, the whole crop canopies are able to absorb more light than individual leaves. And here on these graphs, we can see that plants also react to the green light to promote photosynthesis. And on the right side graph, I'm sorry if it's not very clear, it represents the leaves of rose crop canopy, which indicates that also the under leaves of the canopy are absorbing light, and is in this case, as just said, mainly green light. Okay, so we finished this chapter and we move to the next chapter, which we will entering the dimensions of light. We're gonna cover now two dimensions of light of three. There are three dimensions of light, and we'll cover now two: light intensity and quantity, one dimension, and light duration, another dimension. So, light intensity. For people, as we previously said, light is measured in lux or lumens and represents the visual light intensity. So it's an important topic here because we still see a lot in the industry, some brands and growers and people talking about lumens. And what we really should focus is micromoles, okay? Because for plants, light is measured in micromoles per second and represents the intensity of photons with wavelengths between 400 and 700 nanometers falling from a light source per second. This is called PPF, photosynthetic photon flux. On the left side image, you can see that the photons emitted from a light source in every direction per second. And in the right hand image, photons with different wavelengths falling from a light source. And when we see micromole per square meter per second, this represents the intensity of photons with wavelengths, again, between 400 to 700 nanometers, falling from a light source to an area per second. And this is called PPFD, photosynthetic photon flux density. Just to give you an idea, as said, PPFD are the photons falling from a light source to a specific area. And just to give a perspective of the size of one micromole per second, it's 602.3 quintillions photons with different wavelengths falling per second. Light intensity, as you can see, influences the rate of photosynthesis. When the CO2 or carbon dioxide assimilation is zero, there is no oxygen present in the leaf. As the light increases, the compensation point is reached. If it is reached beyond the compensation point, the rate of photosynthesis increases until the point of saturation is reached. Photosynthesis depends on the intensity of light, whereas respiration is constant. From this graph here, you can notice that as the light increases, the compensation point is reached. And if it's reached beyond the compensation point, the rate of photosynthesis increases until the point of saturation is reached. After the light saturation point, then supplemental carbon dioxide may be needed to null the constant rate of photosynthesis. With no supplemental carbon dioxide on these scenarios, the increase of light intensity will promote the photoinhibition of the plant. So, light quantity, or DLI, daily light integral, it's basically how much light is really necessary. It isn't the light intensity, PPFD, which is instantaneous light we just covered, we should only consider. It is also the DLI, daily light integral. Integral means all possible available photons to the plants are accounted for and is measured in micromole per square meter per day and represents, again, the daily photons falling from a source to a surface area every second over a 24-hour period. This box is just an example of, in this case, a box filled with photons that fell from a light source in the past 24 hours. So, for example, it's just also to give an idea, 1,000 micromoles times 3,600 seconds, which is the number of seconds in 1 hour, equals to 3.6 mol per square meter hour. Thus, if we multiply 12 hours of light, which is typically what cannabis in flowering stage needs, it will need around 43.2 mol per day per square meter. In the below picture, it's just we show the recommended minimum 650 micromol per second per square meter during 12 hours to achieve recommended cannabis DLI. Obviously, that this is just a reference. Usually, it will be higher than 650. Here is just an example, or in this case of a greenhouse. In January, the DLI, or the daily light integral, inside of a greenhouse in the Netherlands, it's about only 3 micromoles per square meter per day. So if you are growing cannabis, you would need to get supplemental lighting of 40.2 micromole per square meter per day to guarantee the photoperiod needs. So plants under a high DLI are expected to have smaller and thicker leaves, more and larger flowers, often faster to flower due to temperature control, and increased stem diameter and root growth. The below figures and pictures indicate that different plants respond to different DLIs. And as you can see, as the DLI increases, the better the plant looks. DLI of a crop is more important than instantaneous light levels provided. So light cycle, light duration, and photoperiodism. Photoperiodism basically is the physiological growth or reproduction or response of a plant when exposed to a specific photoperiod or day length and the corresponding period of darkness. There are three categories of photoperiodic plants: short day, that they flower in less than 12 hours; long day, flower in 12 hours or more; and day neutral, doesn't have constraints to flower. Photoperiodic control of flowering is one of the most practical applications of light control in the horticultural industry. And here is just some examples of short day plant and day neutral plants. In this case, strawberry cannabis short day and day neutral tomato. Of course, that too much supplemental light can cost you more, and disorders on your plants can be expected. It's important to know how much light you need, how much light intensity is required, how it should be set up, when to switch them off, as well as be aware of the basic light principles and have suitable light source for plant variety. For example, here in these pictures, of course, you can see that some impact of too much light, in this case, can create bolting in lettuce, and for example, foxtails in cannabis are some of the effects. So we finished the two dimensions of light from three, and now we move to the third dimension of light and last dimension of light, which is light quality and spectrum. So, light quality describes the relative amount of light in the different wavelengths of the visible spectrum, again, 400 to 700 nanometers, the PAR region. The plant shape changes due to controlled light. It's defined by photomorphogenesis. Then there are different kinds of photoreceptors that affect photomorphogenesis. A phytochrome, 350 to 800 nanometers, cryptochrome, 320 to 500 nanometers, and UVB photoreceptors, 280 to 350 nanometers. Phytochrome provide information about environment and light composition changes. They play an important role to regulate vegetative and reproductive development. Phytochromes are a class of photoreceptors in plants. They are sensitive to light in the red and far red region of the visible spectrum and can be classed as either type 1, which are activated by far red light, or type 2 that are activated by red light. Just on the right image, of course, that the peak on the left, we're talking about the red, and then the far red on the smaller peak on the right side. Okay, cryptochrome absorbs primarily blue, which is the function of phototropism. Phototropism is when plants growing towards light. And UVB photoreceptors, there are still few details known about the effects of ultraviolet light, UVB, but we'll touch on UV and UVB and UVA light further in the presentation when we mention the products, because there is still not enough evidence, but there are some evidence that are related to impacts on cannabis and other plants of UV. For example, as per this table explains, the blue region promotes, I'm not going to touch on all lights, on all colors, but I focus, for example, on the most important ones or the most proportion-wise ones. The blue region promotes photosynthesis, leaf growth and thickness controls respiration, photomorphogenesis promotes strong root growth and is good for seedlings. It is also important to mention that blue is the most important spectrum color for vegetative stage. On the other hand, the red color of the spectrum is the one that impacts most flowering stage. And as you can see, besides flowering, photosynthesis, germination, higher quality and higher yields, stem growth, leaf expansion, fruit production, chlorophyll production. So referring to the spectral distribution or the relative number of photons of blue, green, red, far red can promote better plant structure, better taste and smell. In conclusion, the three dimensions of light we covered before combined together enhance the proper growth of plants. The image here represents these three dimensions of light, light quantity dash intensity, quality and duration, and each needed to promote a healthy, are needed to promote a healthy plant growth. But if we can adjust each dimension with the proper ratios depending on plant species, the better you will produce yield, plant structure, and flowering. Just to summarize, of course, that these three dimensions of light, they play an important role to all areas on the right. But if we had to make a direct association between each of them and an impact on the plant, we would say that light intensity and quantity has a greater impact in yield, the spectral and the light quality has a greater impact in plant structure, taste and smell, and the photo period has a greater impact in flowering, so the inducing in flowering. Okay, so we finish this chapter. We finish the dimensions of light, and now we move to a chapter on why we should consider LED grow lights. But before going into the LED grow lights and LED technology, we will also touch on the other technologies we have been used to. So, other type of fixtures and technology. We had incandescent lights, and incandescent lights, they provide little blue spectrum, which is essential for plant growth. They are less efficient than other artificial lights. They produce more heat than any other bulb. They have a short life cycle. Then we have HPS, high pressure sodium, that I'm sure you all know. They produce more light while using less electrical energy than the incandescent bulbs, but they produce a considerable amount of heat, and the distance between plants and these lights needs to be higher. Again, HPS lamps emit a high amount of red spectrum light and less amount of blue spectrum, making them suitable for greenhouse applications to supplement natural sunlight and encourage blooming. Of course, that there are spectrum limitations and many other limitations on the HPS technology. Usually HPS fixtures, they last 12 times longer than incandescent bulbs, but 5 to 6 times less than LED fixtures. So we also have metal halide, MH. They emit blue spectrum light, making them very common for indoor growing operations for plants that will not flower, such, for example, cannabis, vegetative stage, decorative plants, herbs, etc., and they have a similar life cycle as HPS bulbs. And then fluorescent lights, that they produce less light than HPS, although far more than incandescent bulbs. These lamps also produce less heat, allowing us to hang them closer to plants' canopy. So now we move to LED, and we will mentioned some characteristics of LED, and in this case, reliable LEDs, grow light LEDs. So LEDs provide a full spectrum, most of them. One difference between LED light technology and the others is the spectrum, the others technologies we just covered. It may appear white, but they are made with several bands of light which come together to appear white. LED light has a smooth spectrum all the way from deep purple through until a dark, deep red. With LED applications, we try to mimic the sunlight. With this procedure, we are trying to give plants the best substitute of the sunlight that has a full spectrum. The top left graph you see here on the image is from HPS. The bottom left is metal halide. The middle top is a fluorescent tube, in this case TL950. The middle bottom, it's the sun spectrum. And on the right side, The middle bottom, you see, it's the sun spectrum. And then on the right side is a full spectrum of an LED. In this case, it's the spectrum of our Zeus 1000 Watt Extreme product. So LEDs, heat production. Another difference is the heat. For example, HPS produce a lot more heat than LED lighting. And LED lights are always cooler and therefore are more efficient and reliable. Just to have an idea, and these specific examples we show here, HPS fixtures waste around 66 of electrical energy just in heat, which is a convention plus radiation, while LED wastes less, 30 to 50% less compared to HPS fixtures. We can see the differences on the below images captured by a thermometric camera, HPS producing way more heat, as you can see, 350 degrees at the lamp surface, mainly because it produces a lot of photons in the red region too. So if we had to mention just some, not all, advantage and disadvantage of LED, we would say that the advantage are light spread and uniformity, the spectrum, doesn't create excessive heat, durability and reliability, lower electricity costs, low wattage models available too, can position the lights close to the canopy, and improve growth characteristics like compact growth, improved pigmentation, etc., between others. LED disadvantages, we can mention the initial investment cost, but even this disadvantage can easily disappear due to the LED outstanding return on investment. Okay, so we finished this this chapter, and now we move to the sixth one, which is we'll try to give you some explanations and points on how can we compare LED grow lights, not just ours, but compare our fixtures with other brands or vice versa. So, one of the elements to take in consideration is the desired coverage area. This is an important point you should pay attention to. Like, often people ask which is the best growing light. It depends, as many grow lights are not suitable to fit in the same grow space. What's the best hanging height? Again, it depends on the stage of the plant growth you are at. First, you should choose the system dimension and the operation dimension, and then choose fixture dimensions and output. So two more factors besides the one we covered. So we have also wattage per square meter. So typically for canopies, we would suggest 300 to 400 watts per square meter, which are levels for hungry plants like canopies. But of course, this will depend on the plant species you want to grow. You can always dim the light to reach the ideal intensity, depending on your growth stage, instead of adjusting canopy height distance. If your intentions are to increase light intensity to high levels of PPFD, you may have to enrich your growth system with carbon dioxide levels. Another factor to take in consideration is light spread and uniformity. It is also important to consider when purchasing grow lights to ensure that photons are uniform throughout the entire canopy. There are manufacturers that focus on the dead center of the grow canopy, for example, 900 PPFD in the center, but if you see on the edges, the values have less PPFD, like 200. So uniformity has an important role in your grow system to avoid uneven canopy. So by this here, we insist that it's important when purchasing a certain fixture, for example, for indoor, you need to ensure that across the footprint the brand is promoting, you should not see a big disparity in values. You should have not uneven values, because if you have uneven values, then you will have uneven canopies. That's not what we are looking for. So reliable LEDs can provide excellent light source and uniformity across all the footprint and across all the canopies. Okay. Another factor, the spectrum, as we previously mentioned, another big thing to look at for sure. There is a spectrum graph with all the colors that you should look at. If the grower wants to grow indoor from seedling to harvest, he should choose a full spectrum fixture. Almost 20% of the spectrum is blue, which is coming from the white LEDs, and it's ideal used for the vegetative stage. Around 48% of it is red, having a greater impact in the flowering stage. And the left numbers of photons are majority green, resulting in chlorophyll production, and ideal to pass through thick canopies, raising the photosynthesis levels. So this dimension of light equals light quality and spectrum will have a greater impact on the quality of the crop, not so much on the yield. Okay, and then efficacy, a very unit of measurement, which is measured in micromoles per joule. It is traduced in how efficiently a grow light can take input wattage and turn it into usable power. This is an important deal to take into consideration, as I was saying. This specification can be calculated by a grower if not provided by the manufacturer. It will be strange if the manufacturer is not providing this information, okay? So you can calculate it by simply dividing the total PPF output by the total input power or power consumption of the feature. Some LED grow lights may have 1,000 watts, but with a low efficacy. So very important. Some more factors, also, of course, the energy consumption. So in the past, people just focus on watts and believe the higher the value, the better. Watts is a measurement, I mean, for the feature. Watts is a measurement of energy consumption. If we consider a single 1,000 watt feature, it means that 1 kilowatt of energy consumption per hour. With this, you can predict your future electricity bill. If you are looking to profit from your plants, you should do the math to see if the profit covers these expenses. And then also very important, reliability of the diodes or the light source in this case. Growers must pay attention to this because there are a lot of diodes manufactured, but not much at the top level. Industry leaders like Lumileds, Osram, Samsung should always be considered. These are high efficient and cooled LEDs that can run a long period of time since electronics work more efficiently at lower temperatures. The lower the temperature of the LED grow lights, the better their performance, durability, in this case lifetime, and reliability will be. Here, of course, on the diodes, decay value, lifetime are very important specs to consider on each diode. Also, some other facts, we have the CRI. So CRI means colored rendering index, and this parameter represents accurately how light can represent plants to its natural color. There is LED light that illuminates your canopy with more purple color, and that will decrease the detection of problems in your plants. So the higher the CRI, the closer a crop will look to its natural color. Growers don't want to work in a purple place. Bigger CRI values indicate more white light from the feature. And then, of course, the quality of the material. The overall quality of the build materials of the feature is another aspect. The chassis must be robust and solid. Aluminum heat sinks are also an advantage to exchange the heat more efficiently. And to finalize the last factors, we have another factor important that is not so used, but it's important to use it. Euro per wattage or euro per micromole. You will see that euro per micro is a more credible factor to take into consideration because there is price per watt and price per micromole. We should not focus only on the price per watt since it's purely related to the feature wattage. Euro per wattage can lead actually to misunderstandings. So when you're looking for an LED, so euro per micromole, it's way more effective. Focusing on feature with a higher efficacy is better simply as plants respond to micromoles and not watts. So growers must focus on the plant needs and PPF output cost. And in this case, to calculate this ratio, euro per micromole, you would simply divide the total cost of the feature by the total PPF output of the feature. And then you have a ratio and you can compare with other light features, LED features. Then you have replaceable parts. Modularity and company support should be a standard to help you decide where to buy. The capability to change a driver, an LED bar, or even a PCB, it helps to create more trust, and it also makes it easier to resell your used equipment or handle faulty equipment. And then to finalize the warranty, another big factor. Make sure you have a complete and long warranty, and more importantly, that the company actually stands for that warranty. Okay, so we finish chapter number 6. So we move to the chapter number 7, Lumatech Horticulture LED Lighting Trend. Basically here, just to briefly, Lumatech has a complete product range that can suit the grower needs for all artificial grow light applications. And in this chapter, we'll try to summarize
how best to decide which type of product to choose for the different light applications based on some important key factors we will cover. Okay, artificial grow light applications. The selection of artificial lighting is dependent on the desired plant response. However, to avoid confusion of different light applications and what type of light is suitable for plant response, we take as reference the following key factors. So the key factors are photoperiodic lighting for greenhouse and indoor crops, supplemental lighting for greenhouse and indoor crops, and sole source lighting. Okay. Okay, for these next few slides, you don't need to read everything that is on the text because it may be too much. So I'll just try to summarize very quickly each slide so that it's we can speed up and go to the what's important. So regarding this photoperiodic lighting key factor, photoperiodic lighting as a key application is the way that sole source lighting is used to induce flowering when growing indoors. When growing in greenhouse, photoperiodic lighting refers to how artificial lighting is used to compensate the lack of natural light. Now, supplemental lighting for greenhouse. For greenhouse applications, we should look for a supplemental light source feature in which a full spectrum is not required, as we are already using the sun spectrum. Okay? So it's recommended also to use a powerful and compact feature because we want to avoid the creation of unnecessary shades. If it's a large equipment, it will create an obstacle to the sun. And of course, with a high efficacy and PPF output. Spectrum-wise, usually white plus red fixtures are ideal for vegetative or low PPFD flowering crops, and red plus blue more suitable for flowering crops. And for example, we have the products on the right side that match these descriptions of products. Or for example here, the ones on the right side are ideal to, for example, the one on the top, a 300 watt greenhouse, it's ideal, it's a feature ideal to improve uniformity on greenhouses, and the one, or to improve the lack of photosynthesis, and the one in the bottom, the 100 watt greenhouse, is an interlight feature that is also to use on the interior of canopies to improve photosynthesis. Now we move to supplemental lighting, but for indoor. I will also just try to summarize quickly. So just first to understand, usually supplemental lighting is a concept that we use for greenhouse. But in reality, we may give supplementation on indoor applications too, either on light intensity through special fixture to provide more PPF output or more light intensity on certain areas, for example, side, bottom, or top lighting, or on light quality, in which we are providing a spectrum add-on through fixtures like the one we see here on the image, a UV LED bar. This UV bar, for example, this add-on, if used in cannabis, will help, for example, enhance taste, flavor, terpene levels, THC, etc. Again, it will impact the quality of the crop and not the yield of the crop. UV in this case. And as I was mentioning, besides the supplemental lighting on indoor for light quality, we also have supplemental lighting indoor for light intensity. And this can be achieved through products like our 100 watt individual LED bar. Besides the previous mentioned benefits, this could also be an important product to improve uniformity on your indoor operation. For example, we give the example of this not so professional operation with the Lumatech equipment. And here we can see that this operation would benefit of some 100 watt bars on the edges to improve the grow room uniformity. Okay, now we move to sole source lighting. Basically, when all light is produced by artificial light sources, it is referred to as solo source lighting. For example, in vertical farming, indoor systems, the elected choice for a single full cycle fixture that can deliver the best high quality and yield crops must contain a mixture of photon colors to provide energy so that plants perform photosynthesis. To select a sole source feature, the grower must search an option with a high efficacy and PPF output, optimized full spectrum, and a good light spread uniformity according to the grow area. Also, a dimming or control function feature should be included to reach the PPFD target for all growth stages. And here on the right side, we give some examples of suitable Lumatech products for sole source lighting. Okay, so now we finish those factors and we just cover quickly a document we have created that will benefit growers a lot. So it's a document that contains all the guidelines for the grower to follow in order to optimize and take maximum out of his Lumatech features for all different kind of artificial light applications with all the previous key factors in mind, of course, which is called the Lumatech Grow Light Strategies. So just taking a brief example from the grow light strategies, this table, for example, here represents an indoor growing stage strategy for the ATF300-Rod Pro model for each growth stage of cannabis. Also, it recommends adjustments such as light intensity, distance between plants and feature, and the correct carbon dioxide levels that growing environment should be at. And here another example, but the same, but for the Lumatech Zeus 1000 Watt Extreme. Can you continue? Yeah. And another example, but this time with some recently launched products that you can see all the growth stages and the recommendations we give. And here a specific example of some strategies to be applied in case you are using a specific product for greenhouse, as the strategies differ a lot if we are growing indoor. Yeah, and finish this chapter, and now we move to why Lumatech should be considered when choosing a grow light equipment for your project. So, I'm not going to go into every detail of each, but I'll just cover the main factors that differentiates us from the rest. So we have a unique light spread coverage and uniformity. We have the finest light spectrum optimized for cannabis. We have benefits that include energy savings, plant and crop performance, and of course, one of the highest real efficacies in the industries. And we have, as we have previously mentioned before, efficacy is measured by micromole per joule. And also very important to mention, as you can see on the right, this year we have won the Best Growing Product Award on one of the most worldwide famous trade shows in the industry, an award given to our Zeus 600 Watt Pro 2.9. Okay. Also, another factors differentiating Lumatech, flexible light intensity, where our LEDs can be dimmed to adjust PPF level to suit crop and growth stage without changing the spectral power distribution or even losing efficiency. Less maintenance required. Our LEDs are rated for 60,000 hours of use minimum, supported by a market-leading 5-year warranty. Reduce HVAC. Lumatech LEDs are highly efficient, and less wattage consumption means also less heat released into the space, allowing for potential lower HVAC loads and operating expense. And of course, safety. Lumatech LED drivers and features are intelligent and feature full circuit protection, including over and under voltage, short circuits, and over temperature protection, and also feature auto power increase-decrease to match the amount of light bars connected to feature. And of course, all our features are CE certified, LVD and EMC compliant. Yeah, more factors, the diodes, like we select only reliable, durable, efficient, low decay and low heat chips from Osram and Lumileds and others, but the ones we used more, Osram for the deep red and Lumileds for the white 4000 Kelvin. Again, quality of the materials, our chassis are solid and our lights have heat sink aluminum to ensure the long life for our entire range of products. And then, as previously mentioned, the euro per micromole market, we have a market lead ratio with recognized world-class quality, and the modularity. We were the pioneers on the modular bar design, where all our feature components are removable and interchangeable. Now, we don't need to go into detail, but here are just, of course, our products can be distinguished by consumers as having been rigorously tested and certified, and below are some of our valid certifications. No need to go to all of them, just to have an idea. And remember DLI, daily light integral matters, to promote yield, so yield increase, shorter the cycles, and to increase quality crops, all these leading to a maximized of any return of LED investment. And yeah, we are coming to an end. If of course you want to go under the catalog or have any questions on the catalog, we can go. Overall, that's it. I want to thank you all. Special thank you for Allegra, and even a more special thank you to Katerina for organizing everything, translating everything. And I hope it was interesting for all of you. And we are of course, available for any future questions you may have or anything related to that. So I hope it was a good presentation for all of you. And again, sorry that I could not be there in person, but I still hope it was good.
Thank you very much, Martin. Μας ευχαριστεί πάρα πολύ που τον ακούσαμε. Ελπίζει να ήταν ενδιαφέρον για σας. Ζητάει συγγνώμη που δεν μπόρεσε να παρευρεθεί. Ρωτάει αν έχετε κάποιες απορίες σε σχέση με αυτό. Ναι, η μέθοδος είναι αυτή που αναφέρατε. Βάζουμε δίχτυα σκίασης συνήθως. Martim, there is a person asking about the photo period and how we can actually reduce it, because here in Greece we have sometimes more sun than it is needed. And we are answering with nets that provide the shadow.
Yeah, in this case, we're talking, of course, about a greenhouse. One of the most common and more efficient ways to reduce it is by curtains. Yes, so it's correct. It's curtains.
Ωραία. Όπως είπατε και εσείς με τις κουρτίνες, δίχτυα σκίασης, αυτή είναι η τρόπη.
And to increase it, if you have a lack of natural light, not now, but in winter, it's with supplemental lighting, yes.
Yes, okay. Thank you. Ευχαριστούμε πολύ. Υπάρχει άλλη ερώτηση? Ωραία, okay. So, thank you very much, Martim.
Thank you very much, and I wish you all a great trade show and the rest of great presentations.
Thank you. Thank you, Martim and Romeo, for the presentation and for explaining everything.
Thank you. Bye.
Θα θέλαμε κι εμείς να σας πούμε ότι εμπορευόμαστε τα προϊόντα της Lumatech τα τελευταία 18 χρόνια και προσφέρουμε την εγγύηση και όλο το τεχνικό, τεχνικές επισκευές για οτιδήποτε χρειαστείτε άμεσα. Είναι μια εταιρεία που έχει πρόσφατα ασχοληθεί με αυτό τον κλάδο, αλλά παρόλα αυτά έχει μπει πάρα πολύ δυναμικά και εξάγει τα προϊόντα της σε τουλάχιστον 40 χώρες. Θα δούμε την παρουσίαση σε ένα βίντεο και αργότερα θα έχουμε και έναν χαιρετισμό.
Hi everyone, my name is Arnau from the company Master Products. In Master Products, we are specialized in equipment for the post-harvest of medical cannabis, such trimmers, sorters, backers, conveyor belts, everything that you can imagine for processing the cannabis. We are an engineering company that manufacture everything in Spain, so we are a European company, and we are exporting to more than 40 countries nowadays. Today we are going to speak the cannabis post-harvest. It's going to be very basic knowledge at the beginning, and we are going to move forward through the seminar is moving forward. But the idea is to give you the basic knowledge to organize your processing rooms, your cleaning rooms, how to know when to trim the flowers, also about the benefits and cons of trimming wet and trimming dry, which is one of the most interesting things nowadays, and there is a lot of opinions. So let's start with that. First of all, I want to say thank you to Agrotica and to Alegre Grow Shop to organize this expo and to organize this seminar, which is very helpful for the knowledge of medical cannabis and to promote it in the Greek market and the Balkans countries. So let's start. The first thing to speak about is to know when and why should we trim and divide the cannabis flowers. The most important is to know when, right? Because if we don't know the right time to harvest our flowers, so we are going to lose properties in our flowers. Or we are not going to have the most valuable parts of the flowers. So to know when the flower is mature enough to be harvested, we are going to look at the trichomes. The trichomes are, you can see in the image, is those... they have a kind of mushroom shape with bulbous head on top. This bulbous head is going to start to get milky when the harvest moment arrives. So we have to look at them by a microscope, and they're going to tell us when is the best moment. We want to preserve these trichomes, so that's the most important. These trichomes are the most important in the flower, so we are going to look at them before processing. Well, during the old cultivation, when the time of harvest arrives, we are going to look at them to know when is the best time to harvest, and also after processing them and after a drying process, we are going to look at them as well to know that we didn't damage them. Then to know why should we trim the cannabis flowers. In the cannabis plant we have different parts. We have the stems, the fan leaves, the sugar leaves, and the flower. The all parts in cannabis are profitable, but in this case we want to focus on the flower, which is has the most profitable part of which is the most profitable part of the plant. The stems, the branches can be used for fiber. In this case, we don't want to focus on that at the moment. The fan leaves are the leaves without much of the properties, okay? So we don't want to focus on them either. So we are going to focus on the flower and the sugar leaf. The sugar leaf are the smallest leaves closer to the flower, and those leaves get properties because the flower spread these trichomes spread through these sugar leaves. So at some cases we want to keep the sugar leaves, and the flower itself we want to keep in perfect conditions, of course. The sugar leaves, when we want to keep them? When we make extractions, we want to keep them because there are trichomes which we can extract. So we are going to keep them on extraction purposes. The flower itself, when we are talking about the recreational flower, or when we want to focus only on flower, we want to avoid the sugar leaves as well, which we can separate from the flower, and we can also make extractions from the sugar leaves, which would be the trim. So then that would be everything here. So now we are going to move to how we can trim and divide our flowers. We can do this process manually, or rather using a specialized equipment for doing so. Processing manually, we will have a very accurate result. The damage to the flower is very low if we do it properly, but the cost of doing that are extremely high. And when we want to automatize all the process, having standardized all the process, because when we are focusing with medical cannabis, we need to standardize and we need to automatize. Standardize in order to always have the same quality, and automatize in order to avoid extra cost, which will make us not competitive in the market. So in the manual way, we cannot standardize and we cannot automatize, but we will have very good results, of course. On the other side, processing equipment is going to help us to standardize and to automatize all this process with minimum human contact with the flower, which is what we are looking for, to minimize the human contact with the flower. All the market is moving to EU GMP, who is not in the EU GMP still, they will have to move to EU GMP in order to being able to sell their product. So the machines, the specialized equipment help us to be able to be GMP compliant. For being GMP compliant, the most important is the materials, the components that are in contact with the flower must be approved, must be certified. And also maintaining the machine. It should not have corners where dirt can accumulate. It has to be disassembled easily and being able to clean and have access to all the parts, okay, in order to clean them properly. Then the processing equipment also help us to standardize and to automatize all the process. We minimize the human contact with the flower, avoiding contamination of that flower. It helps to standardize because we will always have the same final result, and to automatize to reduce labor cost. To automatize all this process, we have different machines. In this case, we have a bucker here. This bucker will help us to separate the flower from the stem. Okay, that's the first process. And there are trimming machines which will separate the leaves, fan leaves and sugar leaves, both of them, from the flower. If we want to keep sugar leaf, there are different kind of machines that are going to help us to remove only the fan leaves and maintain the sugar leaves. During all this process, we also have conveyor belts to move from the bucker to the trimmer. After the trimmer, we would like to sort the flower by sizes, which is also very important for the drying room. We will reduce the time that the flower has to be in the drying room, because if we sort the flower by size, not every flower needs the same time in the drying room. Right, drying room are also limited, and if we have small flowers, those flowers need less time than the biggest flowers. So that's why it's important to sort the flowers before moving to the processing room. So then, should we trim wet or dry? That's the big question. Is the question that we get the most, and well, actually, it's one of the most difficult to answer. There is opinions for everything. We should say that both concepts have their benefits and their cons. In this case, what we want to focus on are the trichomes. Before, we say that we want to keep trichomes in perfect condition. So we always suggest that in the processing room, we should have a cold temperature. Cold means below 18 degrees. Even lower would be great, in order to keep those trichomes and not damaging them. In wet, that's even more important. When we are trimming wet, so the process must, wet means freshly cut flowers. So it means that the flower is being cut, let's say in an hour. Okay, in an hour should be processed. Of course, this time is also relative, because temperature is very important. Humidity is very important. We cannot cut the plants and keep the plants in an area that where we have like 26, 27 degrees with high humidity. Well, actually, the flower itself has high humidity, and if we have 26, 27 degrees and we accumulate those flowers are going to start to oxidate and they are going to start to ferment. So it's important to move those flowers after cutting into a cold area, and the trimmer should be in a cold, in a cool room, below the 18 degrees, in a perfect condition. So trimming wet, trimming freshly cut flowers, we will get a more precision cut without losing of product. Okay, product, I mean flower. So all the leaves are tight, okay, so we can get accurate result around the flower without damaging the flower and without having loss of flower. Also, we will speed up the drying process in the drying room, and we will need less space because we are going to remove all the fan leaves, all the stems. We are going to remove all these parts, so the humidity level is going to be lower than if we put all the fan leaves, all the stems, and so on. So we will need less time in the drying room, and it's going to be more easy to control the humidity levels, and the probability to have less mold is also bigger. In cons, it means that all production is come at once, okay, because I say that it has to be cut in an hour, let's say, but all the cannabis plants, they are getting ripped at the same moment, so we'll have to harvest all at once. So all the production is in a short time, and we need to process them immediately. It means that we'll need more trimming equipment, and also more workers will be needed. So the investment is higher. On the other side, trimming dry, the production comes progressively because we have to control all this drying material in a drying room, in a control area, and we will everything will come progressively. So it means that we need less workers and also less trimming equipment to process all of that. But we'll need also a bigger drying room. Okay, that would be a con, that we need a bigger drying room to store all the materials. Also, it's going to be more difficult to control the humidity because we will have the fan leaves, we will have the stems, and so on. So humidity level is going to be more difficult to control. And the probability to have mold or humidity issues is going to be higher. So then also another con is that the product is very fragile. When the product is dry, the product is very fragile. So we should always keep a percentage of humidity in flour. We don't want a dry flour, totally dry. We always want to keep a percentage of humidity and the external surface of the flour dry. Dry enough to break these leaves that are coming out from the flour. So the first questions we have to ask ourselves is, can I organize the harvest and it can come progressively? Can I organize in different rooms, in different stages, or I have a feel and everything is going to come all together? So that are the points that you need to consider in order to take a decision, a proper decision. We cannot say that it's better wet or it's better dry. It really depends how you're going to do it, how is your structure of organization. Okay, if you can organize it, you have different indoor rooms where you can organize to trim those rooms separately. You can organize also to have a trimming room with a cool temperature, and everything is in the same building and so on. Then wet trimming is an option. If you have a big field or a big greenhouse where all the product is going to come at once, maybe then dry trimming is also a better option. We also have machines that can do both, can do wet trimming and can do dry trimming, which is one of the best options because then you can trim as much as you can on wet. Okay, then you dry it when you don't have more time, and then after drying you can do the process. The process must be done what rather is wet, when the leaves are straight, okay, and we can cut them, or rather when they are dry, because the leaves are going to start to wrap into the flower, and if those leaves have humidity, it's going to be very difficult to trim them, to break them, to cut them around the flower. So we need the external surface dry and the flower with a percentage of humidity. Every different concept of machine works in a different percentage of humidity. So you can contact us to know more about which percentage should we trim. And we cannot say that one option is better than the other one. Both have their pros and their cons, and we have to take everything in consideration. And this is what we do in Master Products. We also assessed our partners in order to take a proper decision if they should go on wet trimming or rather they should go on dry trimming. Now we are going to move to know how to design and prepare a processing room, what to take in consideration when we design a processing room. We say that the importance of having a cool room, that's why it's also very important to have a specialized processing room. So in our building, to design a room only for processing the cannabis. So we can adapt these rooms to the needs of being GMP compliant. All the market is moving to GMP compliant. The ones who are not still GMP compliant, they will have to be. So it's very important that when we design, we take this in consideration. So the most important, air conditioning, right? To being able to lower the temperature of the room. I would say that one of the most important things. Well, obviously the correct space and electrical installation to handle all the equipment. We also have to take in consideration if we are going to increase our production. When we prepare all the room, we have to think about the future, where we want to go. We need to organize the room for being able to increase the equipment, to increase the power of the machines. That's very important. For example, electrical installation. We want to avoid the sockets on the walls. We want sockets hanging from the ceiling in order to have clean spaces, no obstacles. Remember that when we are doing the harvest, the processing of the flowers is one of the most important stages of the cultivation. We have been working 2 months, 3 months, 5 months for this moment, right? For processing the flowers and having the flowers being harvested. So that's very important. That's very important. There is going to be nerves. There is going to be everything has to be done fast. Okay, so it's very important not having obstacles in the processing room. So rather we put the sockets from the ceiling. The power supply, as what we said before, we want to be being able to supply all the equipment that we need to fit into a room. Also, obviously, the dimensions of the room. Something is very important in any production plant or factory is a well-defined input and output circuits. So we need a door where the input of product is going to come in, an output door where the product is going to come out. This output door should have access directly or nearby to the drying room, because the flower is in a cool area, it needs to be processed and immediately should be going into the drying room where humidity is going to be controlled and also temperature. A smooth flooring, of course, we are always focusing about GMP, of being GMP compliant, so smooth flooring is also very important. It's also very important to keep the room fully clean and being able to clean the room properly. Water drains, water installation, purified water, very important, purified water. We have to take this in consideration as well. Air circulation and purify this air. We should recirculate this air and purify it. Okay, that's also very important. We know that the cannabis has a strong smell, okay, and could not be healthy for the workers that are there, so we should recirculate. Something I would like to add about having well-defined the input and output circuits is that normally when we are working GMP basis, we will have to scale all the product that is coming in and the product that is coming out. So we have to take that in consideration. We are used to assess our partners with layouts, defining the input and output circuits. Is something that we offer, is a service that we also offer. So feel free to ask us if you have any question regarding how to organize the processing room, where should I place this machine, where should I place the other machine, so we can help you with that. And also to organize all the circuits. Okay, so now we are gonna move to why and where do we need a cleaning room. Cleaning is essential to achieve a peak productivity and quality. The cannabis flower is very sticky, has a lot of resin. And this resin is gonna get all the blades of the trimming, all the processing machines, everything full of resin. This is like a glue. Motors are gonna heat up. So we'll have these kind of issues, the challenges, okay, to solve. That's why it's very important when you want to invest on processing equipment, you need to check how I'm going to maintain this equipment, because you will have to clean this equipment every 4-5 hours of work, depending on temperature. We spoke about temperature. So if the temperature is higher, the resin sticks more into the machine. If the temperature is lower, the resin sticks less. But we will have to clean the machine every 4-5 hours. So that's why it's very important to have the cleaning room nearby the processing room, no far away. The machines that is able to be disassembled without tools. That's why our engineers are focused a lot about designing the machines like tool-free, okay, without the need of any tools to clean the machines and to remove all the parts and to have access to the parts that need to be cleaned. So the first thing you need to check when you want to invest on equipment is how you are going to maintain it. Because obviously, if you don't have it clean, the productivity goes low, okay? And also, because of productivity goes low and the flower has to stay more time into the machines, also the quality of flower is also lower. We should say that in a machine like this one, for example, is a trimming machine, we need around 20-30 seconds for the flower being cut. If this machine is dirty and has resin and is not cutting properly, it can take like 1 minute, 1 minute and a half for being cut. So that's very important. So in the cleaning room, what we have to take in consideration? Water drains, because how we are going to maintain the machines. We clean the machines with the ultrasonic washing machines or rather jet pressures. We use water. The best way is with hot water. We recommend hot water. Then our different companies have different cleaning procedures, but we believe that hot water is works very well for removing all the resin parts, and we do the final hygienic, the final sanitation with disinfection, sorry, with isopropylic alcohol. Okay. So we will need waste water drains. So we will clean the machine with the jet pressure, hot waters. Hot water is going to go to the flooring. So we need to drain this water. And after the cleaning, we are going to disinfect the machine with isopropylic alcohol. Then we need a correct water installation, means that we will need hot water, as we said, and purified water. This is very, very important. When we are talking about GMP, all the water must be purified. Smooth floors for being able to clean those floors. These floors are gonna get a lot of dirt, so it's very important to being able to clean them. Electrical power supply, it's also very important. As we said in the processing room, we need to be prepared for the future. We need to be prepared. We are designing new machines, ultrasonic washing machines will save a lot of cost than rather using a jet pressure. So we have to be ready for that. Compressed air is also something that we need to take in consideration. It's something that we use a lot in the cleaning room. So now I would like to show you different ways of processing. We have several ways, always working in their way. They have their benefits, their cons. So we have to take everything in consideration. What's our final destination of the product? That's one of the most important things, and what we want to do with our product, and what's the production that we have. So that's the most important. As you can see here, for example, we have the plant. From the plant, we are moving to a trimming machine, which is a focus of removing all the biggest leaves. From there, we can hanging the plants. That's an option, and then from drying we can rather do the final trimming, or rather we can grind everything, mill everything for extraction purposes directly. Then we have another option of harvest the plant. Then we can back. When we say backing, we mean separate the stems from the flowers. We can do the wet trimming, and then we can dry the product in nets. And then after the drying, we can rather mill all the product, or rather for extraction purposes, or rather sell the flower itself. Well, here we can have different kind of combinations. We can rather back using the standard, well, the leaf trimmer, and then just drying on nets, and then mill afterwards, doing a dry trimming. We can back before doing the wet trimming. We can also back when is the flowers are freshly cut, and then we can dry on nets, and then rather we can do a final trimming before later. So we have different ways of doing that. So everyone has to organize, has to know their procedures, their protocols, their way of working, their final product destination, what are their clients looking for, and then take a proper decision. As we said, we can assess you with everything, with all of that. We have to listen to you. Is what we like is to listen our customers, to know more about you, to know what you guys really need, and with that we can give you a proper way of working. As you can see, there are different options of doing all the harvest and processing the flower. We can back before drying. We can use the leaf trimmer and then mill everything, or rather do the dry trimming, or rather do a backing, trimming wet, and then drying on nets. So it's about the needs. So we need to know what's your goal? What's the goal of your final destination? What your client wants? So is what we do in Master Products is to listen our partners, to know more about them, to know what they really need, and to help to achieve the result that they want. So we are open to listen to you. Feel free to contact us at any time, so we can discuss all your needs and try to find the right direction to assess you. And now, just to finalize with my speech, I would like to show you in the screen which products we have in our catalogs, what we can help you with. We are, as we said, we are an engineering company. We also build customized equipment for our partners. All our products are made in stainless steel and stainless steel 304 and 316. We customize for clients, so we can build whatever you need. We can also supply IQ and OQ documentation for being GMP compliant. All our products are made of stainless steel. We have traceability of our production, serial numbers. If you ask me for a certificate of a machine that we produce on the 2021, we can supply it. If you ask for certifications of the brush, whatever you need, we can supply all the certifications. And now, just to finalize my speech, I would like to share the mentality and the DNA of Master Products. For us, the clients are partners. We are not looking for a sale. We are looking for a long business relationship. For us, the client is not an end. It's the beginning of a long-term collaboration. We want to grow together. We want to listen to your needs. We want to know more about what you're looking for, your feedback, each market. Listening to the specific needs of each client of each market is our goal, to know more about it. R&D, that's also our purpose. As we said, we design the machines for being able to disassemble without the need of tools, which for us is one of the most important things, to have a proper quality of equipment and a proper quality of flour. Integral support. We want to help you before the sale and after the sale. For us, the sale doesn't finalize when we ship the machine from our factory. We want to hear what are your feelings, what's your feedback, to make sure that you are successful with the machine. We are confident about our products and the quality of our products, so we need to give knowledge to our partners for them being able to reach the maximum performance of the machine and the maximum quality. We don't want unsatisfied clients. We want satisfied and successful clients, which will make us also successful. And for being successful, we have to give technical support, everything engaged, right? Technical support after the sale. Our goal, and with everyone that you speak with about Master Products, they will let you know that Master Products is always behind their products and always giving support. That's our best marketing. And then, as I said at the beginning of the speech, engineering service. We give service to this engineering service and design to our partners. We also, our partners help us to improve as well. So we are open to any kind of project. So if you have any idea, we are open to listen to you. And documentation, we are GMP compliant, our equipment is GMP compliant, we are prepared for that, the market is going that way, so we can provide IQ and OQ documentation on all our medical line of products. We have two different line of products, medical line of products and the professional line of products, more focused on agricultural purposes. On the medical line of products, we can provide IQ, OQ, all certifications needed for GMP. And with this, I want to finalize my speech. I would love to be there, but because of personal issues, I couldn't be there in person. So thank you so much for all your time. And I hope that you enjoy this speech, that you learned something. If you have any questions, now I'm connected for solving all these questions that you might have. And also, I invite you to connect with us and to solve any question that it come up after the expo, after the speech, or whenever you need. Thank you so much to everyone, and enjoy the rest of the Agrotica. Thank you.
Ευχαριστούμε πολύ που παρακολουθήσατε και αυτή την ομιλία. Υπάρχουν ερωτήσεις? Εγώ ήθελα απλά να προσθέσω ότι αναφέρθηκε πολύ ο όρος GMP και ίσως δεν προλάβετε να τα δείτε, δεν ξέρω αν το γνωρίζετε. Είναι οι ορθές πρακτικές παραγωγής που πρέπει να τηρούνται και στα τρόφιμα πολλές φορές και ιδιαίτερα στα προϊόντα τα φαρμακευτικά. Αν θέλετε να δείτε και πιο αναλυτικά τα προϊόντα αυτά, έχουμε και καταλόγους τους οποίους μπορείτε να τους δείτε. Θα συνεχίσουμε με την επόμενη ομιλία που έχει να κάνει με τη συσκευασία. Η οποία έχει μια ευρεία γκάμα προϊόντων από πρέσες για την εκχύληση, προϊόντα για το άτμισμα, αλλά σήμερα θα εστιάσουμε στη σειρά των προϊόντων της συσκευασίας, τα οποία μας βοηθούν το προϊόν μας που το έχουμε καλλιεργήσει όλους αυτούς τους μήνες να διατηρηθεί η ποιότητά του όπως ήταν, να μην είναι αναλύωτο. Θα μας μιλήσει γι' αυτό ο κύριος Edgar Orantes, που είναι ο υπεύθυνος των πωλήσεων.
Thank you. Good afternoon. And I'm very happy to be here because of this invitation from our friends and official distributor, Allegri Grow Shop and Agrotica, to share some interesting things that we love so much of our products. Okay, so we will start with this conference or chat, let's call it this way, to not be so formal with the seminar. Sometimes that gets scary, but we are going to be having fun, that's for sure. What we are going to be speaking is about the effect of the environment into the natural products. And we have to be aware that all natural products are affected directly by natural phenomena. But this is understandable, and the best way to try to reduce this is by a good packaging. We need this phenomena for our lives. And it doesn't matter what type of product is the one that we are working with, if it is either flowers, concentrates, edibles, these all are affected because are very sensitive to the environment. And we cannot change this phenomena because we need them for living. But what we have to do is to try to mitigate the effect on our products. For example, let's say that the air that we breathe every day contains 21% of oxygen. And as a result of this oxygen, you can see what happened to food. It oxidized. So we need to do something to try to reduce that. Also, the sun. I enjoy very much being under the sun for many hours. But flowers do not appreciate that much. Every time, every minute that flowers are exposed directly to the sunlight, the UV rays is going to be affecting its structure, and it will be drying it in excess. And we don't want that to happen because it will be losing its characteristics. Perhaps you also want to consider using packaging and good quality packaging if you live with kids or with pets, because they're safe or their security is also a commitment for us. But the good news is that Kunubu has effective and affordable solutions for these problems. Why we do packaging? And the main reason is because we want to maintain the quality of the products as long as possible. The key clue for keeping the long life of our natural products is packaging. But also human decisions will help to complete this process. For example, let's say we don't want to put never put flowers into regular plastic bags. Because what happened is that the plastic bag creates the energy that will do like a magnet effect. And if you drop the flowers inside, the trichomes will stay in the stick to the bag. So for me, it's a surprise to find this here, the solution, because I was just thinking about it. But here we have a vacuum container. This, just by pressing a button, we can take out air. Another alternative is specialized packaging. These are Mylar bags that we can also use for keeping our flowers safe. Concentrates are affected by air just like flowers are affected by sunlight. So the best way to keep the concentrates is we can recommend also the Kunubu silicone containers. Because with these containers, with these, even if it's very hot, still we have to put it into a fresh place and dry. But if it's very hot, even we can put into the fridge or into the wine cooler. I will not recommend to put it into the freezer unless you want to keep them for a very long time. And edibles also should be considered. Edibles have to be, it's very difficult to tell or to differentiate from regular food. So this can create a problem or a confusion and becoming an accident. So it's important also to use appropriate packaging. We have available tin cans or even Mylar bags that can be labeled conveniently. Okay, so now, we can look at this picture, and let me ask you, how much time do you think these chips will last fresh and crispy without this special packaging? And think about it. How much money or how much you will be wasting of your flowers, your concentrates, or your edibles if you don't use the right packaging? Now, another surprise from my friend from Alegre, because I was having here in the presentation, but we have it here live. And this is another level. This is an automatic sealer. And this is just another level, because sealing will prevent from flowers or all, any other type of product from drying. I can say that there are four important things about sealing. And the first one is to protect the products from what we were speaking about, the phenomena, to not be exposed to mold, to humidity, and to rotten. The second one is the hygiene. It will be kept in good conditions. In the inside, because it's a hermetic sealed, and also from the outside. Third, this will make our products look attractive. Remember, or let's think about when we want to eat something, it's always we start eating with our eyes. If we see something that is dirty, something that is not in good presentation, we don't want to consume it. Also, if we have the products for selling, they will not be selling if they are not in a good presentation. If having a good presentation will be easier to sell. And the fourth, and also is very important, is money. Because either if it's for your own consume or for selling, always you will be keeping your products for a long time in the best conditions possible. Well, but if you think that we are getting to the top, you still have to wait a little bit more, because this is a machine that has three functions: sealing, vacuum sealing, and gas flushing. And you can do all of these three functions separate or at the same time. You can set timing, you can set speed, and you can set everything to do it automatically. We'll be speaking now about modified atmosphere packaging. This we call it MAP. Before we were explaining that oxygen is in the air. So what we do with this procedure is to take away or suck the air and replace by flushing nitrogen. Nitrogen is the appropriate gas for conserving vegetables, also plants or flowers in our case, all cannabis products. And this, we recommend to use these bags, aluminum bags. Once you flush the nitrogen in and it's sealed, it's very resistant. I love when we do the presentations, always I step into the bag after finishing and it doesn't break. Okay, so we were speaking about then many problems, but also benefits. And all the benefits that we were saying, like extending the shelf life, keeping them hermetic sealed, reducing the possibility of getting mold or any other type of contamination, you will find it in this machine. Then, as the end of the presentation, we have to say that the best result is for you and your money, because you will be saving. As we were saying, is with either if it's for your own consumption or for selling. This is a great solution. Packaging will help you to preserve for a long time your products. Alegre Grow Shop is inviting you to take some samples. We have here in the front some things, that packaging and also some extraction things that I have seen, I've been looking. It will be a great, we will be very happy if you can come to the table and get some things, or either if you can visit us at stand 50 in the pavilion 2, that's correct, or even visit Alegre Grow Shop on the website. Thank you.
Ευχαριστούμε πολύ. Do you have any questions? Okay.
It would be very nice if... okay.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Yes. Αν θέλετε, μπορούμε να θέλετε μια ενδεικτική τιμή για αυτό το προϊόν. Ναι, ναι, ναι. Θα σου πω αμέσως. Νομίζω είναι γύρω στα 400 ευρώ. Θα σας πω ακριβώς όμως την τιμή.
While you are looking, Katerina, I will have to say that I appreciate very much your question, because I forgot to say that it's very affordable. I said that it was affordable, but it gives the impression that it's very expensive. And believe me, it is not. It is, with few amount, you will save a lot. I was not prepared for having this price list, but even you can come to us anytime, and we will be sure that you will be surprised about the prices that you will be getting. You can use any type of product. We've been selling even from peanuts, from meats, everything. You can use it for everything. You can press anything. Plastic, aluminum, the sealer works fine with any type of material. We recommend using aluminum foil for the NitroVac, because since you are going to be injecting the nitrogen, it's more more resistant.
Okay. Yes, ναι. Λοιπόν, μπορείτε να βρείτε... Καταρχήν, το προϊόν αυτό είναι ολοκαίνουργιο, είναι και διαθέσιμο για πώληση εδώ. Έχει 420 ευρώ. Όπως είπε και ο Edgar, φαίνονται μερικές φορές η επένδυση σε ένα μηχάνημα ότι είναι μια αρκετή δαπάνη, αλλά από την άλλη έχουμε αρκετά ωφέλη τα οποία δεν μπορούμε δυστυχώς να τα έχουμε χειρονεκτικά.
And also you get technical support directly from us, and it's guaranteed.
Ωραία. Είπε ότι, όπως ακούσατε, ότι υπάρχει τεχνική υποστήριξη απευθείας από την Gnubu. Και εμείς στο Allegra Grosshop έχουμε δικό μας τεχνικό, ο οποίος επιλύει όλα τα προβλήματα και ό,τι δεν για πιο άμεσα δηλαδή. Και ό,τι δεν μπορούμε, εννοείται, το μεταφέρουμε. Και υπάρχει και εγγύηση. Benjamin.
Hello.
Hi. Let me do a fast introduction.
Please.
Okay. Λοιπόν, τώρα θα μιλήσουμε πάλι για την αποθήκευση και τη συντήρηση. Η Boveda είναι μια εταιρεία που παράγει κάποια φακελάκια υγρασίας, όπως θα δείτε σε λίγο, για τη διατήρηση υγρασίας σε ευαίσθητα προϊόντα, όπως είναι, για παράδειγμα, τα πουρα. Έτσι ακριβώς είναι ευαίσθητη και η κάναβη στην υγρασία. Και θα μας μιλήσει περισσότερο γι' αυτό ο κύριος Μπέντζαμιν Πάτοκ, που είναι ο επικεφαλής των διεθνών σχέσεων στην Boveda.
Okay, good. I understood my name and Boveda, so that's really good. Well, yeah. Welcome everybody. Thank you for having me. Sorry for not being here unfortunately, my wife, she has tested positive for COVID, so I have to stay at home. That's what life is. So I'm happy to have the opportunity to be here, like, virtually with all of you.
Thank you all for coming by. I want to talk about a very specific topic when it comes to cannabis storage in the post-harvest process, and it's the issue of moisture. Yes, so I work for Boveda. Boveda, our company is in humidity control for 25 years, and we're in the cannabis space for over 14 years now. So, but let's, before we start to go into detail, let's talk about what quality really is. So interestingly, if you look at the definition of quality, you see that it's always the standard of your expectations, if you so will. So if you measure something against against your expectations, basically. So we talked about quality. So it's always, when people talk about quality, it's always they measure their expected quality versus the perceived quality of a product or service. And as you might know, the expectations that you have about a product can vary and might not be within your own realm of control. So when we talk about quality in the context of cannabis, of course, we have to differentiate between medicinal and recreational cannabis. So if we look at the dimensions of quality when it comes to cannabis, we have, of course, for the medicinal side, the potency, the effect that cannabis has on your body. But on the recreational side, as well as the bouquet, so the smell, the aroma, the look, how it actually looks, and the taste of the cannabis itself. So, of course, we can measure these. So if we want to quantify these dimensions, we can measure the cannabinoid content. We can measure contamination of our flower, hopefully the lack of contamination. We can measure the moisture, in this case, water activity, and I will define it in a little bit. And we can measure the terpene contents, or the terpenes that consist of flavors and aromas. And I think it's important to understand that in the recreational world, it's been for a long time, but also in the medicinal space, that the focus of just THC and CBD is over. So today we're able to identify over 100 different cannabinoids. Some of them don't even have names yet. And usually around 100 different terpenes as well, who are in this very same flower. And it seems that the all of these might be interacting, which is known as the entourage effect. So when we harvest the cannabis plant, we cut it, right? So we disrupt the flow of nutrients, and which means that the plant is decaying, so it's rotting, if you so will, right? And this is an effect that happens automatically, if you so will. That's okay, you can go to the next slide as well. It's basically just to show that there's a process that is happening, it's a natural process that leads to the decay of the plant, and they all have to do with moisture. And one of the process that we have seen in the pictures is basically the process of drying and over drying. So all these things that we see on the screen are happening in that process, and all of them are related to the level of moisture in the cannabis plant. Next slide. And one important process is evaporation, especially when it comes to very volatile plant compounds such as terpenes. So this is the process of terpenes evaporating from the trichome. If I don't know if they can play the video, if not, it's just an image. So in studies that we did, we saw up to 22% of terpene loss in just a couple of weeks, and that is within a closed jar, within a closed container. So these are just terpenes that were lost into the headspace of that closed container. So we have to talk about water activity because it's the most precise metric for when it comes to moisture. Because many of you might know moisture content, also known as loss on drying, however you measure it. But this is just a quantitative measure. It will tell you how much moisture in general you have in your plant material. So water activity, it has the word activity in it. It means there's this movable active water and there's bound water. So water activity really describes how much energy that movable water has to fuel biochemical processes. So it's really a qualitative measurement of moisture in your flower. So here you see some of the processes that are happening in cannabis, not only in cannabis, but generally. And as you can see, they're all related to the level of water activity. Yes. So we see, that's very steep. So it should be straight up. I wanted to show that if you look at above a water activity of 0.65, you have the growth of microbes like molds and yeast and bacteria, which ultimately leads to the destruction of your product. Okay, so that means that we need to store cannabis flower below a water activity of 0.65. But we talked about the evaporation, and we talked about that it's happening fast, especially in the first couple of weeks. And this evaporation is happening at an accelerated rate below a water activity of 0.55. And this is why ASTM International, which is an internationally acclaimed standards organization, have proposed water activity limits for dried cannabis flower of 0.55 to 0.65. So this is just a summary, basically. So because what's happening is that between the water activity of 0.55 to 0.65, which relates to a relative humidity in the surrounding air of 55 to 65%, you have a protective layer of moisture around your trichomes. So there is, of course, a relationship between moisture content, which is also commonly the standard, especially in the medicinal world. Yeah. So for instance, if you take in Germany, which is one of the most interesting medicinal cannabis markets, the legal limit in the pharmacopoeia is a maximum of 10% moisture. So unfortunately, as you can see from the screen, this 10% moisture is very low. It's way below the recommendation of 0.55 water activity by ASTM, which means that the cannabis flowers that you have as a German patient are generally very dry and lacking terpenes. So it's been dried, and then the supply chain of cannabis is quite complex, and you will lose moisture in every step. So, and that is especially if you don't use a humidity control and package in a way that has a high leakage, like this here by a Dutch medicinal cannabis company. So for instance, this container in the picture can leak up to 6 milligrams of water per day. And that means that even if you package it perfectly, after a little bit over 2 weeks, your cannabis will be below 0.55 water activity, even in that closed container. So we, in the United States and Canada, we did a test. And as you can see, most of the cannabis that's sold in the market is way below 0.55 water activity. And even in Germany, we tested medicinal cannabis flower. As you know, as I told, the limit is 10% moisture content, but on average flowers came in at 7% and they can be as low as 4%, which is really, really dry. So, and one of the answers to that is to control the humidity inside your packaging. And ASTM, the International Standards Organization, recognized this, and they, in the first version of the standard, they recognized a salt-based control sachet to achieve that optimum storage. They later had to change that wording because Bovada is the only provider of salt-based humidity package, and they don't do advertising for singular products. So, and this is how Bovada, all basically all humidity control sachets work. They all have water, and they have a special membrane that would only let water molecules or water vapor go into both directions. A little bit like a Gore-Tex, right? Keeps the water in, but lets water vapor out. And they have some sort of controlling agent in order to guarantee you a certain humidity level. And in the case of Bovada, that's salt. There are other products that use other things that are not as precise, let's say. So here we see a comparison between a product that's stored with Bovada, a product without any storage aid, like no moisture control, and a product that uses glycerin. As you can see, they all perform very inferior. Because what's happening is that there's if you store between the level of 0.55 and 65, so you have to be very precise, and only Bovada can give you that precision. But only if you have a precise product, they will form like this micro layer of moisture around the trichome. And if you, this should be a video again, I don't know if it's working, if you click again. So you see that micro layer of moisture that's forming somewhat. So if you go to the next slide. So here you see an interesting fact that that even you as a, if you don't want to go to a lab, you can see the effect of the moisture layer. So what's here in this graphic, we see the perceived smell of ground versus unground cannabis flower. And we see that especially above the water activity of 55 above, you see there's a large difference of smell between the ground and the unground flower. Why? Because if you have the flower that's still intact, the moisture layer is still intact. And once you grind it, you open it up and you free all the terpenes and you're able to smell them. And that makes sense, because if you can smell it, then your terpenes are not in your flower anymore. So it's really about, because there's so much effort in growing cannabis flower. There's so much effort goes in, and so much work and money goes into that process, that it really needs protection. But it's not only about the quality, if you so will, it's also about money. Because as we all know, cannabis flower is sold by weight. And if you sell a product that's too dry, you sell a product that's too light. So I won't go through this, but maybe if people want to take a picture of it. So this is how much money you lose, basically, if you sell your cannabis that's very dry, let's say at 30% or water activity of 0.30, as opposed to selling it at 58 or 62 that you could do with Bovada.
Αυτή ήταν η παρουσίαση. Σας ευχαριστώ πολύ. Υπάρχουν ερωτήσεις? Okay. Benjamin, could you tell us the The average life of a Boveda bug, of a Boveda sachet?
Yes. So, rule of thumb is about 3 to 4 months, basically. But it has to do with the seal of your packaging, how dry your environment is, and how much moisture your cannabis flower has. But on average, 3 to 4 months.
We have no more questions.
All right. Then Efaristo, thank you all. And I hope you have a great conference and a great trade show, everybody. Thank you very much.
Ευχαριστούμε πολύ. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you, Benjamin. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ που παρακολουθήσατε τη σημερινή μερίδα. Μπορείτε να μας βρείτε... Καταρχήν, μπορείτε να πάρετε υλικό που υπάρχει στο μπάγκο για περισσότερες πληροφορίες και μπορείτε να μας βρείτε στο περίπτερο 50, στο stand 2, όπου θα βρισκόμαστε όλοι εκεί για περισσότερες ερωτήσεις. Ευχαριστούμε πολύ.